arrived at the Center for Land Use Information at the former Wendover Air Force Base, where the infamous atomic bombs, the Little Boy and Fat Man, were tested. And even now, the surrounding landscape, desiccated in gray Tommy painting, is used for bombing practice. That night, we stayed at a casino hotel across the state line in Nevada, dining in the feral glow of slot machines and large flat screen TVs. We've entered a world unfamiliar and strange to most of us, Nancy's world. The next morning, we drive into the Great Basin Desert, entering eventually a sweeping, scrubby plain encircled by mountains. In the distance, we spy an arrangement of four concrete cylinders, each 19 feet in length and 9 feet in circumference, and each weighing 22 tons. Sometimes, two pairs of two, the cylinders point toward one another, causing us to peer through one to the other and beyond it to the horizon. We walk around and inside these gorgeous grounds. The walls are punctured with holes, arranged in patterns evoking the constellations Draco, Perseus, Columba, and Capricorn. Drops of sunlight quiver in the cool interiors. When I think of Nancy, a few adjectives stand out. She was warm. She was interested. She was serene. Above all, Nancy was determined. The world did not meet Hull's work when she started out. That's true of any artist. But just imagine the challenges involved in creating Sundance, the earthwork, and film. Imagine Hull driving around Utah to find a plot of land that could yield the precise sightline she required, a plain surrounded by mountains offering several distinct points of view, located at the precise latitude and longitude where, at the dawn of the summer solstice, the sun would, indeed does, rise triumphantly above the crest of Pigeon Mountain. Imagine her hiring some 40 collaborators, all men, engineers, road graders, dump truck operators, concrete pourers, core drillers, truck drivers, ditch diggers, cameramen, salmen, a helicopter pilot, a crane operator, and even an astrophysicist and an astronomer. Imagine her directing the transport of these weighty drums from the faraway foundry and laying them down in the sand. Imagine her funding this monumental venture without the support of patrons, largely with her own savings. Imagine her living on site for a year, sleeping in the desert alone in a camper for nights on end. Hull was determined to see her ideas through. Her early practice revolved around three concerns: the manipulation of light, the staging of acts of looking, and the revelation of place. In mirrors of light, the mirror discs hung at a slant cast circles of light on the surrounding walls, causing us to perceive the gallery as a space and ourselves standing in it. While in views through a sand dune, her first earth, located on Narragansett Bay, daylight has replaced artificial light, the natural world, the white cube. The work of art was no longer something to look at, but was itself a viewing device, a channel of perception, enticing us to look outside of ourselves at the actual places where we stand. Finally, in Sun Tunnels, a fourth term, the cosmological, entered Holt's system. The subject of this masterwork is nothing less than the movements of the universe itself, the rotation of Earth around the sun and the celestial progress of the stars of the night sky, marked by the patterns of constellations that pour sunlight and moonlight inside the great cylinders. Staring at these trembling spots of light, we actually see the Earth move, and we perceive that we ourselves are Earth-bound beings. October 2018. I'm looking at a photograph of Nancy. She's standing on the Bonneville salt flats. Her body casts a long, long shadow. She beams at the camera. Holt had accomplished what she set out to do. She had developed a unique body of work, citing her projects in cities and remote places around the US and beyond. She protected the legacy and work of Smithson, who who died far too soon. And she had found a community of friends and supporters who felt passionately about her work and her legacy, as so many of us here tonight do. At the end of that remarkable day, we drove to a hill above the ghost town of Lucen. The land we stood on was hers, a panorama of desert scrub hills and western skies stretched out before us. "Look," she told us, "look at where we are." Although she'd been coming here for nearly 40 years, this place, this unique place, still filled Nancy with wonder.